I wanted to look at a passage here in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Our Tuesday morning Huntley Bible study, we have a Q&A on occasion, and we actually had one yesterday morning. And one of the questions asked had to do with the thorn in the flesh that the Apostle Paul refers to here in chapter 12. And the assumption is that when Paul refers to the thorn in the flesh, that he's talking about some mere physical ailment or disease. And that is not the case. And frankly, if you restrict the thorn in the flesh to merely some sort of physical ailment, physical disease, you really are going to miss a very important dispensational meaning in the verse. So let's read the verses, and then we'll look at it a little more closely. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 6. For though I would desire to glory, I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. But now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. Our Father, again, we do thank you for your grace. We thank you for your goodness and love. We, of course, thank you for the work of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, who willingly went to Calvary and shed his blood for our sins. We thank you for your word. And as we get to know you in a deeper way, may we certainly understand how it is you're operating in this current dispensation of grace. And may we also learn what is happening to the Apostle Paul and how it is he had to experience this thorn in his flesh. As always, may our time together prove to be edifying and enlightening. And as always, may all things redound to the glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. The verse we're going to focus in on, verse 7, where Paul says, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. Now, he explains why he was given the thorn in the flesh. There was the potential danger of the Apostle Paul being exalted by the church, whether it's the Corinthians or any other local assembly. You notice at the end of verse 6, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be. So the potential problem is for people to begin to idolize and worship the man, the Apostle Paul. The issue, of course, isn't the messenger. The issue, of course, is the messenger. So it isn't so much Paul who was in jeopardy of thinking of himself more highly or exalting himself in his own conceited viewpoint. No, the danger is for others to exalt and magnify his person. For that reason, verse 7, lest I should be exalted above measure, through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. Now, we certainly need to recognize that Paul is using a metaphor. Now, could Paul be referring to a literal thorn or a literal splinter in his biological body? Well, that's a possibility, but it wouldn't be consistent with the way thorns are used in Scripture. Paul is deliberately borrowing a metaphor from the Old Testament to convey some things about what's happening to him, but more than that, to convey some things about what is happening in the current dispensation. Because quite frankly, the expression thorn in the flesh is actually conveying a deeper meaning. And I hope that we recognize that. Now, when Paul's talking about the thorn in his flesh, it isn't just the annoyance in life. It isn't the discomfort in life. He's not suggesting that, you know, there are things that will happen that can be a nuisance and difficult in life. The thorn in the flesh metaphor is a pretty serious metaphor. Now, the first time we learn about thorns, okay, the law of first occurrence, you remember when that took place, right? Don't go to Genesis 3, but rather go to Hebrews chapter 6. Of course, you remember in Genesis chapter 3, the fall takes place, sin entered in the world. By one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And as a consequence of sin entering into the world, what did God do? He cursed the ground for Adam's sake. And by cursing the ground, we read back there in Genesis chapter 3 that thorns and thistles are going to grow. And as a consequence of the thorns and thistles, Adam, by the sweat of his face, is going to have to work the ground. And then God ultimately says, you're going to return right back to the dust. So at the outset, thorns represent or are a type and shadow of a curse. So just let that roll around in your thinking as we go through some verses in the Old Testament. The first time we learn about thorns, it's associated with a curse or the curse. Hebrews chapter 6 is a great verse that re-emphasizes or affirms the correlation between thorns and the curse. If you notice there in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 7, for the earth which drinketh in the rain that cometh oft upon it and bringeth fruit forth herbs meet for them by whom it is dressed, receiveth blessing from God. But that which beareth thorns and briars is rejected and is nigh unto cursing, whose end is to be burned. So again, we have a verse that will provide this correlation between thorns, and in this case, briars, and again, the curse, which is meat for burning or destruction. By the way, that's why the Lord Jesus Christ had a crown of thorns placed upon his head. Now, not that the Roman soldiers understood anything about God's word, but we can't miss the typology. Jesus Christ was the king of rejection. When those thorns were placed upon his head, he is the epitome of the curse of God against sin. You remember what Paul writes there in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13? Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. So it's not surprising that our Lord Jesus Christ is hanging on a cross with a crown of thorns. Again, he's the king of rejection. He's the recipient of God's curse against our sin by being made a curse for us. So thorns, obviously, not a good thing. We can appreciate some of the typology and some of the shadows, okay? When Paul uses the expression, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. In fact, might as well go over there because Paul's going to elaborate. Now notice what he does. This is why Paul isn't just talking about mere disease or a mere physical ailment. Because when he writes in verse 7, 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. Notice how he elaborates, the messenger of Satan to buffet me. To buffet means to beat, to struggle, to battle with, okay? So when Paul's referring to the thorn, we already know it's a metaphor. It's a representation of the messenger of Satan that is targeting the Apostle Paul, his message, and his ministry. Why would Paul borrow language from the Old Testament? And by the way, we know who the master author is, okay? When Paul wrote 2 Corinthians, it was written by inspiration of God. So when I say, why would Paul borrow an Old Testament metaphor? We ultimately understand who is reaching back to the Old Testament and using language. It's, of course, God the Holy Spirit. It's God who authored this book. So the Lord is the one who is going to use this metaphor. Let's go back and just notice how the language is used, okay? And then I trust we'll recognize the significance of Paul's usage of that expression. If we go back to Numbers, okay? Go to Numbers chapter 33. Numbers chapter 33. And just be mindful that what's happening here in the book of Numbers, God, he's giving to Israel the allotments, the inheritance. God is going to divvy up the promised land by allotment of 12 tribes, so on and so forth. And as God is preparing the nation of Israel for the occupation of the promised land, there are various borders that are drawn up for the 12 tribes. But there's a problem, and you know what the problem is. Somebody else is occupying God's land. The promised land, the land of Canaan, is occupied by Gentiles. So as God prepares Israel to receive the allotment of the inheritance, which is the division of the promised land, there's going to be the need to evict these Gentile nations and tribes. And in light of that, God gives a warning. And so just that's what's happening here. Numbers chapter 33, and notice there at verse 55. Well, let's read verse 54. And ye shall divide the land by lot for an inheritance among your families, and to the more ye shall give the more inheritance, and to the fewer ye shall give the less inheritance. Every man's inheritance shall be in the place where his lot falleth, according to the tribes of your fathers ye shall inherit. Verse 55. But if ye will not drive out the inhabitants of the land from before you, then it shall come to pass that those which ye let remain of them shall be pricks in your eyes and thorns in your sides, and shall vex you in the land wherein ye dwell. So what's the warning? Listen, this is your land. By the way, God says you're going to see the strong arm of the Lord. I'm the one that's going to lead the military operation to evict these Gentiles from the land. But here's the deal. If you fail to remove all of the inhabitants, Gentiles, the nations, then they're going to afflict you. And one of the reasons God commanded Israel, when you go into the land, you're going to kill them all. You're going to destroy young and old and so on and so forth. And there are various reasons for that. But if you don't drive them all out, then those remaining Gentile nations are going to afflict and persecute you. The enemies of Israel, the Gentile enemies of Israel in the Old Testament, are likened unto thorns and thistles and pricks and briars. So think about this. If thorns are a type of curse, are the Gentiles the people of God? In this period of time when God is dealing with the nation of Israel, when God says, listen, I'm going to give you my land, it's my land, and I'm going to give it to you by inheritance, it's fitting for the Gentiles to be described as thorns. Why? They're cursed. Now, I don't think we have to go to all of these verses, but we know something about the status of the Gentiles. God gave up on the Gentiles. Paul, he writes over there in Acts chapter 16 that he's going to go to the Gentiles to deliver the Gentiles from the power of darkness and from Satan. In fact, Gentiles are consigned to the control of Satan. So think about this. Not only are the Gentiles cursed, they're unclean. Hence, God says, I am separating Israel from among the Gentiles. I'm not going to number you with the Gentiles. What does Paul say about the Gentiles in Ephesians chapter 2? Without God having no hope in the world. Romans chapter 1 is very clear. God gave them up. God gave them over. God gave them unto. The Gentile nations are cursed by God, cut off, separated, abandoned, and are now consigned to the operational control and influence of Satan himself. The Gentiles, by default, are in the kingdom of Satan. They'd have no claim to God. So Think about the thorn represents the curse. God says, you better drive those Gentiles out. The land is unclean. The land is occupied by people groups that are severed and cut off from the life of God. They have no claim to God. And so those Gentiles are cursed. It's fitting they're called thorns. But more than that, the Gentiles are being used by Satan to afflict and persecute the Israelites. So you see what I'm getting at here. Paul, he's using language that conjures up and actually it sort of kind of percolates a lot of doctrinal truths that are taking place in the Old Testament. The Gentiles are cursed. The Gentiles are part and parcel of the satanic policy of evil that are being used to persecute and afflict the nation of Israel. Go over to Joshua chapter 23. Joshua chapter 23. So there's an interesting pattern. Joshua. Now, of course, you know Joshua is the great book of conquest, all right? In Joshua, you have the nation of Israel, the new nation of Israel. Remember, the first generation passed away in the wilderness, and so now there's this new generation that will occupy the promised land, and in the book of Joshua, you have God himself leading the nation into the promised land. Now, notice what the Lord says, Joshua chapter 23 and verse 13. Joshua 23, verse 13, know for a certainty that the Lord your God will no more drive out any of these nations from before you, but they shall be snares and traps unto you, and scourges in your sides, and thorns in your eyes, until ye perish from off this good land which the Lord your God hath given you. Now, the warning is, Joshua issues a warning at the end of his life. Listen, you go back to idolatry, you go back to the pagan ways, you go back to worshiping the Gentile gods and idols and so on and so forth. God says, this is going to be a certainty. Those Gentiles will be snares, traps, scourges, thorns in your eyes. Go over to Judges chapter 2, Judges chapter 2. Remember what happens in the book of Judges? Israel says, we want a king just like the nations. We want a king just like the Gentiles. And so, of course, God, he does take it rather personally. He says, listen, you know, you don't want me to be your king? Then I'll give you a king just like the Gentiles. But be aware, that king, he's going to take from you. He's going to oppress you and so on and so forth. But Judges chapter 2, notice there at verse 3. Wherefore I also said, I will not drive them out from before you, but they shall be as thorns in your sides, and their gods shall be a snare unto you. One more passage, go to Ezekiel chapter 28. A number of times we read in the Old Testament that at that period of time, the Gentiles, cut off from God, under the curse of Almighty God, operating under the influence, the course of this world, the prince and the power of the air, they're functioning as messengers of Satan to, again, afflict and persecute God's people. In this case, obviously, the nation of Israel. Ezekiel chapter 28, and here's something that is being foretold out there in the future. Ezekiel chapter 28, notice there at verse 24. And there shall be no more a pricking briar unto the house of Israel, nor any grieving thorn of all that are round about them that despiseth them, and they shall know that I am the Lord God. Now, this is going to be out there in the future, the millennial reign of Christ. You know, there's going to come a day where Israel will occupy her land unmolested. She'll occupy her land without the threat of these Gentile nations that are surrounding her. There will come a day, as the end of verse 24 says, they shall know that I am the Lord. Here's the hope, that there will be no more a pricking briar unto the house of Israel, nor any grieving thorn of all that are round about them that despise them. So you see the metaphor here. God has no problem describing these Gentiles that hate Israel. By the way, one more. You know what? I just got to think. Go to Judges. Go back to Judges chapter 9. You know, here's another interesting shadow and type. So God has no problem. You go to Judges chapter 9. God has no problem describing these Gentiles occupying the land as those who despise the nation as thorns. So it's a metaphor. Okay, we know it's a metaphor. That's what the thorns represent. Hence, Paul is using a metaphor. Now, here's the ultimate thorn, okay, if we could say it that way. Judges chapter 9. And you know, Jotham's the parable of the trees and so on. And if you read the entire context, you've got the fig tree in verse 10. And then you've got the vine tree in verse 12. And then there's an olive tree in there somewhere. But what we're going to look at specifically is verse 14. Look at verse 14. Then said all the trees unto the bramble. Now, you know what the bramble tree is, right? It's not a good tree. Thorns, thistles, briars, pricks. The bramble, again, that would be the thorns and the thistles, okay? All these other trees, not interested. When it comes to the bramble, the thorns and the thistles, verse 14, then said all the trees unto the bramble, come thou and reign over us. And the bramble said unto the trees, if in truth ye anoint me king over you, then come and put your trust in my shadow. And if not, let fire come out of the bramble and devour the cedars of Lebanon. Now therefore, if ye have done truly and sincerely in that which ye have made Abimelech king. So there's a representation here with Abimelech. Abimelech is a type of the Antichrist. Ultimately, you know what this parable is referring to? Verse 14 and verse 15. The thorn, the thistle, the bramble tree ultimately represents the Antichrist. So, God, he uses this language to communicate and depress by way of imagery the attributes and the characteristics and the nature of, let's say, the Gentiles, thorns and thistles, and then ultimately the Antichrist, who is the ultimate bramble, thorns, and thistles. So, again, we can just appreciate what's going on there in the Old Testament. So, let's now fast forward about 3,000 to 4,000 years. Go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. So when Paul uses that language, the thorn in the flesh, you got to think, well, wait a minute. Okay, it's used to describe Gentiles, but wait, Gentiles in a very specific context. Gentiles that are cursed, Gentiles that are used instrumentally by Satan, Gentiles that are afflicting and persecuting God's people. Those are the three points that I hope we recognize. If Paul's saying he's been given a thorn, is there someone cursed when Paul says that? And is whoever is cursed being used instrumentally by Satan? And are they afflicting God's people? What I'm getting at is things have completely turned 180 here. In time past, the Gentiles cursed use of Satan to afflict the nation of Israel. You know what's going on with Paul? Now you have the nation of Israel, cursed of God, being used by Satan to afflict Paul and the early churches of the body of Christ. So when Paul uses the metaphor, we really need to to appreciate the significant, the dispensational thrust and significance that Paul is referring to here. He's using the thorn metaphor because, wait a minute, the tables have turned. Now, let's just identify who the thorn is. So again, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, right in the middle of the verse, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. He elaborates, the messenger of Satan to buffet me. Okay? Now, let's go back to chapter 11, because Paul, he's already said something about Satan and a core of ministers that he utilizes as instruments of his assault against the church, the body of Christ. Paul says, whatever's going on with this thorn, it's a messenger. Now, we notice, for example, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. And you know what the light represents. It represents revelation, represents knowledge, represents information. Satan's objective today is to manifest himself as a source of understanding, a source of knowledge, a source of wisdom, albeit corrupted, but nonetheless. An angel, by the way, by definition, is a messenger. So, you know, you start thinking about a messenger of Satan. So anyway, verse 14, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Verse 15, therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. So in other words, you have Satan, who is working behind the scenes, who deploys the false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles. There are a bunch of counterfeits. But as an angel of light, they are fraudulently seeking to represent Christ. Paul continues, if you drop down to verse 20, for ye suffer if a man bring you into what? Bondage. Paul's now going to paint the picture of what this man is. By the way, if a man bring you into bondage, if a man devour you, if a man take of you, if a man exalt himself, if a man smite you on the face. You know what's going on? There's an individual who is part of the ranks of the ministers of righteousness, participating in the satanic angelic ministry of revelation. And Paul knows who this, Paul knows what's going on at Corinth. He knows what this guy is doing. You have to understand something, that in the early ministry of the Apostle Paul, as he's traveling and he's establishing ministries and churches and so forth, there was this concerted effort to undermine Paul's authority, to poison the minds of these newfound babes in Christ, and to sow the seeds of legalism. That's the messenger of Satan. Paul says, that's my thorn in the flesh. It's not merely, you know, in chapter 4 he talks about the outward man perishes. You know what? We all have thorns. It's called life. It's called death. It's called illness. Paul is taking us back to the Old Testament. Wait a minute. Remember those thorns back there that antagonized and afflicted Israel, the instruments of Satan, and they're cursed by God? Satan's using people at this period of time who are cursed by God to afflict, antagonize, and persecute the church, the body of Christ. Now, drop down, verse 22. Again, Paul, he's painting a more detailed portrait here. Verse 22, are they what? Hebrews. Wait a minute. And is the nation of Israel cursed today? The answer is yes. We'll look at the verses. Is the nation of Israel being used by Satan today? I should say specifically when Paul's writing. I'll say it this way. When Paul was establishing these churches, he's writing to the Corinthians, he's writing to the Thessalonians, he's writing to the Galatians. Was Israel cursed? Yes. Was Israel being used by Satan? Yes. Was Satan using the cursed nation of Israel to afflict the church, the body of Christ? Yes. When Paul says a thorn in the flesh, the dispensational significance is, yeah, there are thorns today, only it's not what it used to be back in the Old Testament. Verse 22, are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths often. Of the Jews. Well, wait a minute. Also, might as well look there. Look at the end of verse 26. The end of verse 26. In perils of the sea, in perils among, here we go, false brethren. Now, we're going to go to the Galatians, to the book of Galatians. We'll go to the book of Galatians, but I just want you to notice how Paul deliberately uses in verse 20, if a man bring you into bondage, if a man devour you. Those are words he uses in the letter to the Galatians. In describing this satanic element that is being used to harass, undermine the Apostle Paul, and poison the minds of the saints. These are Jews. The messenger that Paul's talking about are elements from the nation of Israel. Go to Galatians chapter 2. And just notice go to Galatians chapter 1. Go to Galatians chapter 1. And just recognize Galatians chapter 1. And verse 8. But though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. So, see this, a man. If you turn over to chapter 2, and notice what we read there. At verse 4, chapter 2, verse 4. And that because of false brethren, Paul referred to the false brethren in 2 Corinthians 11, verse 26. False brethren, unawares brought in, who came in privily to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into what? Bondage. That's the same language we find in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. In fact, over to chapter 5, notice how Paul, he warns the Galatians, listen, you persist in grafting legalism to your identity in Christ. You know what's going to happen? Chapter 5, verse 15. But if ye bite and devour one another, that's the language Paul used there in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. There's a man who's bringing the saints into bondage, who's out there devouring the saints. They're false brethren, and they're smiting the face of the saints. Again, they're poisoning the grace identity that the saints are being brought up under. So let's go over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And again, when Paul does make a reference to Satan, how is Satan doing this? 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and notice there at verse 18. Wherefore, we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once again, but Satan, what? Hindered us. Okay? So, the thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me. Paul, he credits Satan as the one hindering Paul's ministry. And when we go to, obviously, Acts chapter 17, we easily can identify how Satan sought to hinder the Apostle Paul. When we go to Acts chapter 17, we have here the passage that describes and provides the details regarding what Paul is doing there at Thessalonica, Acts chapter 17, verse 1. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica. And then you know what he's doing, verse 2. He's reasoning with them at the synagogue out of the scriptures. But what happens? You drop down to verse 5. But the Jews, which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city in an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason. Wait a minute. Now we're going to see the Jews. They're the thorns. They're the antagonists. They're the afflictor. They're going to be the persecutors. And we'll see why in a moment. But so as a result of this uproar in verse 5, you drop down to verse 10, and the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea. So Paul was hindered in continuing his ministry at Thessalonica. Satan hindered Paul's ministry by recruiting and using these fallen Jews, these false brethren, to assault Paul's work. So as a result, Paul goes to Berea. Look there at verse 13. But when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached of Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people. And then immediately the brethren sent away Paul to go, as it were, to the sea. But Silas and Timotheus abode there still. And they that conducted Paul brought him to Athens. Paul's in Thessalonica, he gets chased into Berea, then he gets chased into Athens. So go back to 1 Thessalonians. So just be mindful, when we go back to 1 Thessalonians, Paul writes in chapter 3, verse 1, 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1, wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we thought it good to be left at Athens alone. So Paul now, as you can imagine, he's concerned. He's unable to accomplish the ministry that he was determined to accomplish, okay? He got chased out of town. And he credits Satan for that, verse 5 of chapter 3, and for this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter have tempted you, and our labor be in vain. So think about it. Satan hindered Paul, but Satan at the same time, he's tempting the Thessalonians. In what way are the Thessalonians being tempted? Satan, via the rioting crowd, is intending to intimidate the Thessalonians so that the Thessalonians now are going to question and hopefully reject Paul's apostolic ministry. They're being tempted to abandon Paul. They're being tempted to reject Paul. Verse 6, but now when Timotheus came from you unto us and brought us good tidings of your faith and charity, and that ye have good remembrance of us always, desiring greatly to see us. Did the tempter succeed? Just because you have these Jews that are now afflicting Paul. They're chasing Paul out of town. The hope was the churches are going to scratch their heads and they're going to reject Paul. You know what the Thessalonians did? They decided they greatly desired to see Paul. The tactic didn't work. The tactic of intimidation, the tactic of discrediting Paul's authority, it failed miserably, at least among the Thessalonians, okay? But the point that we certainly want to emphasize is, wait a minute, who are these? Who is the thorn? Let's quickly go back to Acts, all right? You know, over and over again, what the book of Acts, and we understand the book of Acts is a transitional book, we have in the book of Acts the record of Israel's diminishing, the fall diminishing, casting away, so on and so forth. And what the book of Acts also clearly demonstrates is Israel is no longer God's people. In fact, we'll see how Paul describes it in just a moment. But over and over again, Acts chapter 13, if you notice there at verse 45, Acts chapter 13, verse 45. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy and spake against those things which were spoken by Paul, contradicting and blaspheming. Verse 50, but the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women and the chief men of the city and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them out of their coast. Chapter 14, verse 19. Chapter 14, verse 19. And there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium, who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing that he had been dead. Chapter 17, verse 5. We already read that. Let's go to chapter 20. Go to Acts chapter 20, and notice there at verse 19. Acts 20, verse 19. Serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. Chapter 21, verse 11. And when he was gone unto us, he took Paul's girdle and bound his own hands and feet and said, thus saith the Holy Ghost, so shall the Jews of Jerusalem bind the man that owneth this girdle. Whose girdle was it? It's Paul's. Chapter 23, verse 12. Chapter 23, verse 12. And when it was day, certain of the Jews banded together and bound themselves under a curse, saying that they would neither eat nor drink till they had killed Paul. A couple more. That's enough verses in the book. But there's a few more verses, by the way. Wait a minute. The attack is against Paul. And the Jews now are the instruments of the adversary. Go to Romans chapter 11. And now just tie this all together. Romans chapter 11. Today in the dispensation of grace, and certainly it was true as Paul launched his ministry at the beginning of the dispensation. Paul says in Romans chapter 11, notice there at verse 28. Romans chapter 11, verse 28, as concerning the gospel, they, and that's a reference to Israel, they are enemies for your sakes. So just picture this. In time past, who were the enemies of God? The Gentiles. And the Gentiles were used to afflict the nation of Israel. Today, the dispensation of the grace of God, God says he's concluded Israel are enemies. Now, that has to do with the fact that God now can conclude all men in unbelief and so on and so forth. But the point is this. Israel, as Paul describes in verse 15, for if the casting away of them, Israel, just like the Gentiles in the past, fallen Israel, cast away Israel, are enemies. Go over to 1 Thessalonians and notice in chapter 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. Israel is cursed. And Israel is being used as we read, for example, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 18, to hinder Paul and to launch the attack against God's people. But notice in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 14, 1 Thessalonians 2, chapter 2, verse 14. For ye, brethren, became followers of the churches of God, which in Judea are in Christ Jesus. For ye also have suffered like things of your own countrymen, even as they have of the Jews, who both killed the Lord Jesus and their own prophets, and have persecuted us. And they please not God, and are contrary to all men, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles, that they might be saved, to fill up their sins alway, for the wrath is come upon them to the uttermost. The tables have turned. When Paul says, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, he's making a reference to the tactic of the adversary who launches his messengers at this period of time, the fallen nation of Israel, the apostate nation of Israel. The wrath of God has come upon them to the uttermost. The thorn in the dispensation of the grace of God is the nation of Israel, unbelieving Israel. And so, again, I think when you kind of see that dispensational significance, you just sort of say, wow. Again, the master authorship of God. Paul didn't use language lightly. He's using that language strategically. Our Father, again, we thank you for your grace. We do thank you for your love. And we thank you for your word. Again, as we continually study it, may we have deeper insight and understanding. May we grow closer to you and understand how it is you're working and what it is you're seeking to achieve today. We thank you for it all in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.